What's the following step for Congress, for Republicans and for Democrats alike? Where do they go from here now that the government is in its third day of being shut down? We've heard this morning from John Boehner. We've heard from Harry Reid. We've heard from the president. The president said this, that giving into Republican threats would be a bad precedent.
If we get in a habit where a few folks, an extremist wing of one party, whether it's Democrat or Republican, are allowed to extort concessions based on a threat of undermining the full faith and credit of the United States, then any president who comes after me, not just me, will find themselves unable to govern effectively.
Well, that sounds like it's in reference to the raising of the debt ceiling, which is a fight that's a couple of weeks away. But how do the two combine? And what's the end game for the Republicans? Don't know. Let's bring in Congressman Mario Diaz-Balart, Republican from District 25. Good morning to you, Congressman. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning, sir. How are you?
All right, great. How do you react to the president's comments? Is he right?
Well, firstly, I think it's unfortunate that the president continues to use this kind of rhetoric. You know, we have to all lower the rhetoric, lower the decibels. And when he's talking about, you know, extortion and all these things, and, you know, he's clearly not in the mood to try to resolve this. And that's unfortunate. I think all of us are responsible, have our level of responsibility for having, you know, all of us up here in Washington, for having gotten us to this position. All of us have to lower the rhetoric and sit down to work it out. The one who refuses to do so, frankly, more than most, is the president of the United States, and that's very unfortunate.
Well, and yesterday there was a meeting, as you know, at the White House with the president, Nancy Pelosi, John Boehner, Harry Reid, and basically Mr. Boehner was told we're not going to negotiate. So is there an end game then, Congressman?
There's a beginning, a middle, and an end for the Republicans, which is, to paraphrase Bill Clinton, it's the spending, stupid. And, you know, we have to control this federal government. We have to stop bankrupting the United States. We have to stop adding money to the credit cards of our children and our grandchildren. We have to stop, putting us in the road towards being the next Greece with nobody big enough to bail us out. So how do you do that? You have to control spending. How do you do that? You have to reform what we call mandatory spending, which are, you know, the entitlements, not only to protect and save the country, but also to protect and save those entitlements. But in order to do all of this, Jimmy, there's only one way to get there. It's to sit down, lower the rhetoric, and start negotiating. Now, here's a president who says that he will not give concessions. But this president loves giving concessions, whether it's unilateral concessions to you know, the worst enemies of the United States, whether it's concessions to Assad or Castro or Mr. Putin, and he's willing to speak and talk to everybody in order to give concessions, but he's unwilling to sit down with other Americans who are willing to talk to him in good faith. And again, the solutions are going to be difficult, but you can't even start to get there without some leadership coming from the president, right, to start talking. All we're asking is, Mr. President, start doing with us what you've been willing to do with all the thugs and all the murderers and all those who kill Americans around the planet, and let's solve these problems. And again, all of us have to lower the rhetoric. Right. The president has to lead.
Congressman, you know, the average American, and, you know, I'm a layman as well, and the people right around here in South Florida listening to our conversation, have a couple of questions, though. When this particular shutdown, I get going forward toward the debt ceiling. That's a whole other fight, right, coming up. But this right now, Senator Cruz, most Americans will look and say, this is all about defunding Obamacare. At least that's what we believe or think that's what this is all about. And it doesn't seem that that's going to be a part of the possibility of this end game at all, is it?
Jimmy, that was not my preferred strategy.
Right.
That's not what I recommended. I think it's been pretty public what I've been recommending from day one. And I always thought, and I have to, you know, we have to not fault for, you know, chasing shiny objects.
Right.
I voted against Obamacare when the Democrats were putting it together.
Right.
I voted to defund it, to get rid of it, to eliminate it over, you know, about 45 to 50 times. I think it's destroying the economy. It's destructive. Now, a small group of Republicans were convinced, absolutely convinced, that if we put on the continuing resolution, the continuing resolution, which is only for 2.5 months,
right?
Which is a way, you know, what we wanted to do in that continuing resolution is a couple things. Is, again, get the Democrats to go to our level of spending for 2.5 months so we can then finalize the appropriations bills at our level of spending. There were a few Republicans who were convinced that, and that's what they were saying, that if we put on the CR, the continuing resolution, the defunding of Obamacare, that they saw a crack in Democrats and that we would get Democrats to go along with it.
Right.
I didn't think, I wasn't feeling that, but, you know, I figured, no harm, let's try it. So we did it. We sent it to the Senate. Unfortunately, our friends in the Senate were not, you know, they weren't able to get
right.
what they thought they could get.
Right.
We did it a second time because they kept saying, no, we're, you know, this time we're going to get it. We did it a second time. The second time, again, it didn't happen.
Right.
There was a third attempt. At the third attempt, I said, no, guys, I'm done. This is not working. We have other strategies. So let me tell you what I wanted to do. But this is, again, this is in the past. What I wanted to do was in the Appropriations Committee where I sit, in one of the subcommittees, by the way, chaired by a Floridian, Andrew Crenshaw, what we did is because of the corruption and the waste and the targeting by the IRS that we can document, we went after the funding for the IRS. We cut the IRS by 24%. Let's put it in perspective. The IRS has more people working for it than the entire U.S. Coast Guard.
Right, right.
So we defund, you know, we didn't defund the IRS. We cut it by 24%. We can justify why that number is there.
Right.
So we said, hey, let's put that as the negotiation thing. And if the president and the Democrats want to close down the government because they refuse to cut the IRS a bit, let's have that argument. Let's have that debate.
Well,
but again, some of our colleagues thought that they saw a crack and that we could defund Obamacare. That was not correct. That didn't take place.
Right.
Now, however, what the important thing I think is to lower the decibels. I think all of us, the Republicans control one-third of the federal government. We should assume that part of, you know, our part of the blame.
Right.
The Democrats control two-thirds. They should assume their part of the blame, and then let's start talking.
Well,
the president is the first one who needs to lead by example, and he refuses.
Well, let's hope that he can find a way to have a conversation. Congressman, it's always an honor and a pleasure to talk to you. I wish we had more time. Let's talk again in the future. I hope so.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate that.
Thank you very much.